Well, good morning, everyone. It is lovely to have you here worshiping with us this morning. And a particular warm welcome to any of you who are visiting. This might be your first time with us, and we're so delighted to have you here. And we would love to invite you to stay afterwards and join us for a tea and a coffee at our little kitchenette in the corner there. We'd love to get to know you, and we're just thrilled that you're here with us today. And a particular warm welcome to those of you who are joining us online. We're so thrilled to be worshiping with you as well, and just delighted to share in this morning together. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Keita, and I recently joined the staff team here to lead the women's ministry, so it's my joy to be leading our service this morning. So, as you know, probably most of you know, today is Palm Sunday, and I love this Sunday because it is the start of Holy Week. So it is the time that we get to pause and reflect and think back to the week that was the turning point in history when Jesus Christ died and rose again. And that's what this Sunday is. It's like the gateway that we cross to take time to meditate on such an important week. So it's a very precious day, and I'm so excited to be worshiping with you on this Sunday. So we are going to be worshiping the Lord together in song, in prayer, and we're going to be continuing our series in the book of Acts, looking at Acts chapter 15, and one of our mission partners, Michael, will be coming and preaching to us later, so we're really looking forward to that. Just to start this morning, I want to begin by sharing a verse from Zechariah. So I just invite you to quiet your hearts and focus in as I read this now. And we want to begin with a word of prayer. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and having salvation, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. Lord Jesus, as the people spread their coats and palm branches on the ground to welcome you into Jerusalem, so we welcome you into our lives this morning. King of glory, King of peace, servant King, reign in our hearts and lives this day and all days, that we might praise your holy name. We invite you into our service this morning and ask that you be glorified by all that we do and say, and we thank you for your tremendous love. Hosanna in the highest. Amen. Let's stand now to worship the Lord with these three songs.
Yeah, let's lift our own hosannas this morning. Let's stand together.
Praises rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you.
See you, we find strength
to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. When we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away. Hosanna. Hosanna. You are the God who saves us. Worthy of all our praises. Hosanna. Hosanna. Fills the night, it cannot hide the light. Whom shall I fear? You crush the enemy underneath my feet. You are my sword and shield, though troubles linger still. Shall I fear? I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. Your strength, my strength is in your name, for you alone can save. You will deliver me, yours is the victory. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. And nothing formed against me shall stand. Angel armies is always by my side. rescue. You alone can save. You alone can lift us from the grave. You came down to find us, led us out of death. To you alone belongs the highest praise. We lift up our eyes, lift up our eyes. You're the giver of life. We lift up our eyes, lift up our eyes. You're the giver of life. We lift up our eyes, lift up our eyes. You're the giver of life. We lift up our eyes, lift up our eyes. You're the giver of life. You alone can rescue. You alone can save.
Gorgeous to hear your voices this morning. It's been amazing.
Okay, good morning, everyone. If anyone doesn't know, my name is Peter, and I work with the kids here at Bruntsfield. And if the kids would maybe like to come up, we are going to do a memory verse today, and I'd like your help with that. But before we do, okay, it's the return of what is perhaps now our new regular feature. What mistake did Peter make this time? Okay, if you were here or you were watching at home last week, you were maybe a bit puzzled by something I said, and a couple of people have asked me about it. Does anyone know? Anyone know what mistake I made last week? You know, you had your hand up. No, you changed your mind. You're not sure. Okay, it was when I read out the list of names, the list of babies. I had two lists. I had my first list, which was all the babies that had been born and are still at Bruntsfield, are still here. And then I had another list, which is babies that had been born that are connected to Bruntsfield but have moved away. And I had that list just in case any of you guys named those babies, I would have them there. But then when we were reading out the names of all the babies that were still here, what did I say? Do you know?
Did you say one of the names twice?
I didn't say one of the names. No, I read the name Lucy, and for some reason I thought, oh, no, Lucy's not here. Lucy has moved away. Her family has moved away. But that's not true. Lucy is here, and her family are here. There they are over there. In my mind, whenever I saw the name Lucy, I was thinking of Jane. I was thinking of the name, and I know those names don't sound anything alike, but in my mind, they are somehow connected. I blame Neighbours, okay, from the 1980s, when I used to watch Neighbours. There was a girl on there called Jane, and there was a girl on there called Lucy. So there we go. That is the mistake that I made last week. And we've been learning about another Peter. Who's the other Peter we've been learning about? Does anyone know? Who's the other Peter that we've been learning about?
The disciple.
The disciple, okay, sometimes called Simon Peter. And he made lots of mistakes, didn't he? He made lots of mistakes. And last week, do you remember what we did last week? What was the mistake that Peter made last week? Do you remember?
He denied Jesus three times.
He did. He denied Jesus three times. After saying that there was no way he would ever let Jesus down. Okay? He said to Jesus, no way, there's no way I would let you down. Never, never, never. I would even die for you. And yet, you know, Jesus predicted, Jesus said, you know, before the rooster crows, you will have denied me three times. And he did. He said, I don't even know that guy. I'm not a disciple of his. No way. And then he remembered and he'd made that mistake. And what Peter needed to do is really connected to our memory verse. And that's what we're going to learn today. So here's our memory verse from Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5. And it says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. Okay? And that's what Peter is needing to learn. Okay? It's what Peter is needing to learn. I should have trusted my sheet that I had instead of thinking, oh no, I've remembered something else. Okay? I need to trust my sheet. We all need to trust in the Lord and not our own understanding. Yeah? Okay, and that's what we've been learning about with Peter. With all these mistakes that he makes, he is slowly learning that he needs to trust God. He needs to trust Jesus and not his own thinking. And today, we'll be thinking about Jesus dying. And we'll be thinking about, why did Jesus die? Okay, and that's the question we'll be trying to answer today. Why did Jesus die? And your parents might want to ask you what you've learned at kids' church. But that's what it is. So let's do our memory verse together. Okay, so did you see the actions I was doing for that? Okay, so the Bible says in Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5, and it's, so trust, yeah, in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. Okay, so let's everyone say it together and do the actions, because I find the actions are really helpful for remembering these memory verses. Okay. So, the Bible says in Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. Super. Okay, let's get some Easter eggs in. Right, let's go again. Ready? The Bible says in Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. Do you want more Easter eggs? Let's have more Easter eggs. Okay, ready? The Bible says in Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. Okay, do you want even more Easter eggs? There we go. You can see through him a bit. You can. So it's not too hard then, is it? No, I haven't made it too hard for you. Right, okay. The Bible says in Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. Okay, well done. Super job. Okay, I want to tell you about this. This is a little giveaway that we've got for all the kids. Okay, so all the kids that are here this week, you will get one of these. It's a little booklet. It was produced by Saddleback Kids. We sometimes use their videos, but they've got all these different coloring sheets and worksheets, word searches, and different things all to do with Easter. So that's a little thing that you might like to do over the Easter holidays. So I'm gonna give them to all the kids that are here. There might be some spares. There'll hopefully be some spares that I'll then put in the foyer at the end of the service. So if you'd like to pick one up, hopefully there should be some there for you, and there'll be more for next week as well to give away next week. Okay, so the rooms. So during the next song, Creation Roots are gonna head out to room 3 with Amy and Naomi. Kids Church, you'll be upstairs with myself and Stuart. And in the embassy, you're having app chat, so that's afterwards. I think they're going to be meeting in the corner. Go there first. If they're not there, then it'll be through in room 1. That'll be with Peter Campbell and Danny. Okay, so let's just pray just now, and then we'll go take our seats and wait for the next song. Okay, so let's pray. P-R-A-Y. Dear Lord, thank you for all the children that are here. And Lord, we pray for those who are away, having a break over Easter. Pray that they would have a good holiday. And I pray for those of us here. Pray that you would help us to learn and to listen well. Lord, and to really think about this question. Why did Jesus die? And Lord, help us to know the truth about that. And for it to be real in our lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so let's take a seat just now.
Thanks so much, Peter. Okay, so every few weeks as a church, we take a bit of time in our service to think about and focus on a different ministry or interview a different mission partner. And this morning, we have the privilege of welcoming Michael to be with us to share a bit about what the Lord is doing in his life. Now, his work is a bit sensitive, so we won't be able to talk too much about his work, but we're so delighted to welcome him here to share a little bit about himself. So if I can invite you on up, Michael, I'm going to interview him now briefly before he comes and brings the word later. So, Michael, great to have you here.
It's nice to be here.
So a lot of us are new here at the church over the last 1 to 2 years, myself included. So I wonder if you could just begin by telling us a little bit about who you are and how you are connected to Bruntsfield Evangelical Church.
Right, okay. Well, my name's Michael, and good morning, everyone. And I came to Edinburgh as a student a number of years ago, and as a lot of folks who come to Edinburgh to study end up staying on, I got involved in a church called Bellevue Chapel on the edge of the New Town in the north side. And, you know, during that period of time when I was studying and then after graduation, you know, gradually felt God calling me to sort of overseas or cross-cultural ministry. And so that kind of led to me going overseas and serving there for a while. In terms of my connection with Bruntsfield here, I think, well, there was a period of time, and I spent 3 years overseas, then came back for two or three years, and then went overseas again. And during that in-between period, I was working with Friends International, which is this organization works with foreign students. And at that time, Bruntsfield was beginning to think about how to reach out to international students in the area. And so I got involved with Bruntsfield a little bit at that time. I think John Gemmell was the pastor at that time. And so that's how I kind of got involved with Bruntsfield. Yeah.
That's great. Actually, that's really helpful because I didn't know that background, so thank you. So as I've said, due to the sensitive nature of your work, we can't really ask you too much about this up front. However, I know that you'd be happy to chat about this with anyone. If you have specific questions afterwards, you'd be happy to chat later one-on-one with people.
Yeah.
But just to hear a little bit about you, we're going to borrow from Graham his 1-2-3 interview format. So what is one thing you've been learning, two things you've been experiencing in this season, maybe over the last 2 years, something that's been an encouragement or a challenge, and then three ways we could pray for you.
Right, okay. I think the one thing I've been learning is that closed doors lead to new opportunities. So I came back to the UK to do an MA degree, and then with the view of returning, but with COVID restrictions and sort of certain countries with zero COVID policies, that hasn't really worked out. However, as I'd spent quite a lot of time with my dad during this period, that meant that I was able to reconnect with the church that I grew up in and left when I was 18 years old. So I was able to really kind of reconnect with people who didn't know me and some folks who had not seen much of me since I was a teenager and grown up with their children who've since also left. So to kind of reconnect with old friends and make new friends in the church I grew up in has been a good thing. Also connecting with Bellevue as well, which is my main commending church. And, you know, a church changes its character over time. And to serve alongside people in the last few months is a good way to get to know people. And that's been a really good thing. So I think these sort of closed doors do create new opportunities, and there's a lot of positive things. And I've also been learning to be flexible during this time, particularly thinking about the tabernacle, you know, God's this tent of meeting. And we discover that it's portable. And I think there are certain things that God can only teach us in the desert. And we need to sort of come into that place where all we can do is really focus on him and learn to be flexible as God teaches us new things. So I would say that's what I've been learning. In terms of what I've experienced during this time, I've experienced God's provision. As I keep referring to, I was back home for a while. And there was a lack of opportunity and a lack of fellowship there, really. And so I approached the elders at Bellevue and asked them if it was possible to come up. But the problem was accommodation, you know, and something was made available. And so that kind of opened the door. So I've discovered that God, well, I know it all along, but we need to learn it again, right, afresh, that God provides for us. And to be sustained by God's word in this process as well. I don't know how you felt during some of these lockdown periods, you know, but I remember being struck by how Paul was in prison, and we read about this in Philippians, and he says that he rejoices in the Lord. And I thought, well, he was certainly more confined than I am. Can't I also rejoice in the Lord in these circumstances? That's just one example of a number, I think, you know, God's word speaking, you know, constantly throughout, you know, whatever process or stage we're at in our lives, leading us and guiding us and showing us how to live and to respond to the circumstances that we're in. So these are a couple of things I've experienced. In terms of prayer, I would say I have an opportunity to go overseas again, and this would be in Thailand. It's a ministry amongst Thai students. So I'm praying about that at the moment. So perhaps you could pray with me over that for the Lord's leading. And that also means sort of leaving my dad again. So, you know, it's not just me, you know, there's other people who are affected by these decisions. So you could pray for him. And also just my faith, I think, in general. And this would be one that we would all pray for ourselves, isn't it? That to be nourished in the Lord during all of these things, all of these seasons, and to be sustained by him. Yeah.
That's brilliant, Michael. Thank you. All right, well, we're so delighted that you're going to come and speak later. I'm going to pray for you just now before we have our next song and the kids head out. So let's just bow our heads right now for a word of prayer. Your love, Lord, reaches to the heavens, your faithfulness to the skies. Your righteousness is like the mighty mountains, your justice like the great deep. You, Lord, preserve both people and animals. How priceless is your unfailing love, O God. People take refuge in the shadow of your wings. For with you is the fountain of life, and in your light we see light. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much that we can come before you this morning and we can rejoice that you are on your throne, that you reign over all the earth. You reign over all things, seen and unseen. And I thank you, Lord, that we can come to you now and lift to you our brother Michael. Thank you for the joy of having him with us this morning. Thank you for the blessing it is to hear how you have provided for him and to be reminded again that you are indeed Jehovah Jireh, the one who provides. And we can trust in you, Lord, like that verse said. Thank you, Lord, so much for how you have been with him and produced open doors at this time and enabled him to reconnect with those who support him. Thank you, Lord, so much that you are faithful to your word and you are faithful to your promises. And we lift him to you this morning with these things on his plate. Lord, I pray that you would guide him and give him discernment with the decisions he needs to make about his next steps. I thank you for giving him opportunities, and I pray that you would lead him in that and guide him. Lord, your God, we do know that going abroad does affect not just us, but our families, and they're part of the sending team. So we pray not just for him, but for his family, for his father, for his church, that you will prepare their hearts to be in partnership with him, to wherever you call him, and that you will sustain them and care for their needs as well. Lord God, we also pray for him and for us that our faith would be strong and nourished by you, that we would stand firm in you, Lord, putting on Jesus Christ, putting on the armor of God, standing firm in you. We pray this for him and for us. Please bless him as he comes to speak to us later in the service, and anoint him by your Spirit to bring the word to us. Lord, we also remember at this time that our world is in turmoil and we cry out to you because we need you desperately, Lord. So we lift to you, Ukraine, Lord. We lift to you this country and we pray for your peace. We pray, Heavenly Father, for your protection over the Ukrainian people and that you would thwart those with evil intentions. We ask that you'd protect the innocent and the ones who are unable to defend themselves. We ask for you to move mountains in this situation and bring justice and righteousness to light. You preserve both people and animals, O Lord. Please do that now. May many take refuge in the shadow of your wings. Please strengthen our Christian brothers and sisters in Ukraine and the surrounding countries as they seek to support the many refugees who are fleeing, and also those who have to stay. Lord, may you have the victory in this, and we cry out to you for your compassion and mercy at this time. And finally, Lord, we lift to you the Ponton family as well. I ask, Lord Jesus, that you will comfort Michael, Fiona, and Douglas and surround them at this time. We thank you for Ruth's life. We thank you that she is safe in your arms. And we ask that you will comfort them and draw near to them at this time. And for others in our family who are suffering just now, Lord Jesus, we cry out to you that you will meet them in their hour of need. And we remember again that you are faithful at all times. You can do all things, and no purpose of yours can be thwarted. So we rejoice in you today, Lord, and we thank you for this opportunity to worship together. Amen. We're going to stand to sing one more time, and the kids, this will be the time that you head off to your various classes.
So let's stand together and sing Cornerstone. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness.
My hope is built.
Lisa to come and bring us the reading. I just want to make a few announcements about Easter because, of course, this next weekend is Easter. First of all, just to say that this is, again, Holy Week, and it's such a special time to set aside time to meditate. And one way that you can do that is through these Easter devotionals that we've put together with various members of the church contributing. There's a stack of these at the front door. Please help yourself. Take one for yourself. Take one for another person. They are just a fantastic way to be able to meditate each day on what Christ has done for us and continues to do today. So do take one of those with you. So coming up this weekend, I just want to highlight a few things about how we are going to be celebrating this precious time together. First of all, so Friday evening, we're going to have a Good Friday service here at 7 p.m. We're going to have time of communion and just a time to reflect on what Christ did by dying on the cross for us. On Saturday at 10 a.m., we're going to have a brunch, which is a delightful time to come together as we prepare our hearts for Easter Sunday morning. Just to say, if any of you are planning on coming and you have dietary requirements, if you could let us know, that would be great. So do see me afterwards if that's the case. Happy to connect you with Jill just to make sure we can cater to your needs. And finally, Easter Sunday itself, we have a celebration service here at 11 a.m., which is a wonderful time to come together and celebrate. And then in the evening, we won't be having an evening service, but instead, we'll be going to the resurrection event put on by Origin. It's in Usher Hall, 7:30 p.m. You do have to book tickets. They're free, but you do have to book them. So if you, I would just recommend doing that in advance because it probably will book up. So that's how we're going to be celebrating Easter. Please come to all these things, and we're just excited to celebrate this time together. I'm going to invite up Lisa now to give us our reading, and then we'll have one final song before Michael comes and preaches.
Morning, church. As Katie said, my name's Lisa, and I'm a member here at Bruntsfield. And this morning we're going to be reading from Acts 15. Which is on page 1110, if you're using the Pew Bibles. So just whilst you find your place, just to pick up where we left off. So we left Paul and Barnabas returning to Antioch, having reported and then reporting to the church there everything that God had been doing through them, especially among the Gentiles. So starting from verse 1 of chapter 15. Certain people came down from Judea to Antioch and were teaching the believers, "Unless you are circumcised according to the custom taught by Moses, you cannot be saved." This brought Paul and Barnabas into sharp dispute and debate with them. So Paul and Barnabas were appointed, along with some other believers, to go up to Jerusalem to see the apostles and elders about this question. The church sent them on their way. And as they travelled through Phoenicia and Samaria, they told how the Gentiles had been converted. This news made all the believers very glad. When they came to Jerusalem, they were welcomed by the church and the apostles and elders, to whom they reported everything God had done through them. Then some of the believers who belonged to the party of the Pharisees stood up and said, "The Gentiles must be circumcised and required to keep the law of Moses." The apostles and elders met to consider this question. After much discussion, Peter got up and addressed them. "Brothers, you know that some time ago God made a choice among you that the Gentiles should hear from my lips the message of the gospel and believe. God, who knows the heart, showed that he accepted them by giving the Holy Spirit to them, just as he did to us. He did not discriminate between us and them, for he purified their hearts by faith. Now then, why do you try to test God by putting on the necks of Gentiles a yoke that neither we nor our ancestors have been able to bear? No, we believe it is through the grace of our Lord Jesus that we are saved, just as they are." The whole assembly became silent as they listened to Barnabas and Paul telling about the signs and wonders God had done among the Gentiles through them. When they finished, James spoke up. "Brothers," he said, "listen to me. Simon has described to us how God first intervened to choose a people for his name from the Gentiles. The words of the prophet are in agreement with this, as it is written, 'After this, I will return and rebuild David's fallen tent. Its ruins I will rebuild, and I will restore it, that the rest of mankind may seek the Lord, even all the Gentiles who bear my name, says the Lord, who does these things, things known from long ago. It is my judgment, therefore, that we should not make it difficult for the Gentiles who are turning to God. Instead, we should write to them, telling them to abstain from food polluted by idols, from sexual immorality, from the meat of strangled animals, and from blood. For the law of Moses has been preached in every city from the earliest times, and is read in the synagogues on every Sabbath. Then the apostles and elders, with the whole church, decided to choose some of their own men and send them to Antioch with Paul and Barnabas. They chose Judas, called Barsabbas, and Silas, men who are leaders among the believers. With them, they sent the following letter. The apostles and elders, your brothers, to the Gentile believers in Antioch, Syria, and Sicilia, greetings. We have heard that some went out from us without our authorization and disturbed you, troubling your minds by what they said. So we all agreed to choose some men and send them to you with our dear friends, Barnabas and Paul, men who have risked their lives for the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, we are sending Judas and Silas to confirm by word of mouth what we are writing. It seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to us not to burden you with anything beyond the following requirements. You are to abstain from food sacrificed to idols, from blood, from the meat of strangled animals, and from sexual immorality. You will do well to avoid these things. Farewell. So the men were sent off and went down to Antioch, where they gathered the church together and delivered the letter. The people read it and were glad for its encouraging message. Judas and Silas, who themselves were prophets, said much to encourage and strengthen the believers. After spending some time there, they were sent off by the believers with the blessing of peace to return to those who had sent them. But Paul and Barnabas remained in Antioch, where they and many others taught and preached the word of the Lord. Sometime later, Paul said to Barnabas, "Let us go back and visit the believers in all the towns where we preach the word of the Lord and see how they're doing." Barnabas wanted to take John, also called Mark, with them. But Paul did not think it wise to take him because he had deserted them in Pamphylia and had not continued with them in the work. They had such a sharp disagreement that they parted company. Barnabas took Mark and sailed for Cyprus, but Paul chose Silas and left, commended by the believers to the grace of the Lord. He went through Syria and Sicilia, strengthening the churches. May the Lord bless the reading of his word. Just before Michael comes up to preach, let us quickly pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the challenge it presents and the comfort it brings. And Lord, we just pray that you would really speak through Michael today. Would he speak faithfully and truthfully to your word? And Lord, would you just be preparing our hearts and our minds that we as a church may be receptive to what it is that you are speaking to us today through Michael. Amen. And just before Michael comes up, we are going to stand together and sing "Speak, O Lord." So let us stand and sing.
Speak, O Lord, as we come. Your holy word. truth prevail over unbelief. Speak, O Lord, and renew our minds. Help us grasp the heights of your plans for us. Truth unchanged from the dawn of time that will echo down through eternity, and by grace we'll stand on your promises, and by faith we'll walk as you walk with us. Speak, O Lord, till your church is built and the earth is filled with your glory.
Okay, good morning again. Thank you for the cup of water there. I wonder if you think that we live in a united country, despite the name of our country. Are we faced day by day with a sense of togetherness and cohesion? Perhaps when you put the news on, for example, or rather confronted by a sense of discord and friction. Louis Theroux, the documentary maker, made the following comment. He said, "We're at a moment in time where culturally we're at odds with one another. There's a lot of rage, a lot of disagreement about a certain sort of wedge cultural issues." And he's really referring here to the so-called culture wars, which I'm not really going to comment on particularly, but just simply acknowledge that that is part of our sort of social context at the moment. If you're not sure what the culture wars are, another journalist has informally described them as those things we shout at each other about on Twitter. And so it might not be a good idea to spend too much time on Twitter. But this is a reference to some of the fractions in society that we see around us, and that is to say nothing of the political disagreements that divide us, or geographical ones. Are you from the east or the west? Are you from the north or the south? And of course, the age-old class divisions that also exist. Well, when it comes to the ancient world, and when I say the ancient world, I'm referring to the days of the New Testament. One New Testament scholar has said that the great divisions in society were those between male and female, slave and free, and Jew and Gentile. And from the Jews' point of view, the greatest of these three was the division between Jew and Gentile, or between Jew and non-Jew. And so to explain the point a little bit further, John Stott has said that Israel forgot her vocation and twisted her privilege into a sense of favoritism. So that even though Israel was intended to be a light to the nations, that gradually over time it actually became a sense of superiority. However, the Gentiles were no better because they looked down on the Jew. And so, for example, they may have regarded the Jews' Sabbath as their lazy day. And so to disregard one group as the circumcised or the uncircumcised is not really a reference to somebody's medical history, but rather a dismissive term of sneering, perhaps. And so for a Jew to regard a Gentile as the uncircumcised is really to say the unclean. And it's against this sort of grand historical background of division that the great move of God we see in the book of Acts takes place, which is intended to open the door of salvation to the Gentiles. And the point of this is not to say that the Jew cannot be saved, but rather that the Gentile can now be saved together with the Jew, and out of the two to make one new man, as Ephesians chapter 2 puts it. But as this was happening, there was, ironically, a certain amount of conflict happening through this movement towards unity. Because a Jewish person might naturally ask, well, what are we to do with our festivals? And what about our clothing requirements? And what about our food regulations? And the most sort of symbolic of all of these distinctions, circumcision, what is to be done with that? Well, that's all by way of background to sort of set us up for what unfolds in this chapter. We're considering Acts 15, a watershed moment. And we're going to consider, firstly, conflict in Antioch, secondly, debate in Jerusalem, and then finally, we'll come to our watershed moment. So conflict in Antioch, then. We've had read to us, these Pharisees have come down from Jerusalem to Antioch. And we remember that Antioch is the place where there are many Gentile believers. And we don't need to rummage around inside this passage and look hard to find where the conflict is or where the problem is. It's stated for us nice and clearly in verse 1. Unless you are circumcised according to the custom of Moses, say the party of the Pharisees, you cannot be saved. Now, why is this a controversial thing to say? It's controversial for two reasons. Firstly, because it concerns salvation. And secondly, because it concerns authority. So in terms of salvation, the question is, do we obey the requirements of the law and are thereby saved? Or are we saved by trusting in Jesus alone without the works of the law? It's quite simple. But this isn't just a technical theological question. This is a question with implications for our lives. Because if we think that our works contribute to or lead towards our salvation, then there are two likelihoods. The first one is we'll think that we have fulfilled all of these requirements and will therefore become self-righteous. And Jesus met many self-righteous people in his ministry. The other possibility is actually you feel overburdened with all of these requirements. It's too much. I can't do it all. And a crushing sense of guilt and inadequacy. However, if you believe it that salvation is through faith in Jesus Christ alone, all of this potential self-righteousness or a feeling of being burdened is replaced with freedom and confidence because it depends on Jesus Christ and what he has done. So this is why the issue of salvation is very important. It's about salvation and it's also about how that in turn affects our lives. The second reason it's controversial is it relates to authority. This party of the Pharisees have come down from Jerusalem. Jerusalem is where the apostles were. And these people had spent time walking and talking with Jesus. And they could compare everything that was done and said with all that Jesus had done and said. And so there's a particular authority with the apostles. And so if these men have come from Jerusalem, the question is this what the apostles think? What's going on in Jerusalem? So we've got this problem here of salvation and authority. Now, last week you considered Galatia, I think, chapter 14 of the book of Acts. And there we see that Paul and Barnabas go through Iconium and Lystra and Derbe. And it looks very much like that after Paul and Barnabas have retraced their steps and come back to Antioch where they started off, that actually somebody has come along behind them. And they've come along to all these different little churches that they've established, and they've said, well, everything that Paul said is all well and good, but you need to be circumcised as well. And that's why Paul then writes his letter, and we can read about that in Galatians. And Galatians is such a big book, how can we comment on all of it? But I want to edit out, as it were, five words from verse 21 of chapter 2, where Paul says, if you go back to the law, Christ died for no purpose. Which seems pretty striking. So let's remind ourselves for a moment, why did Jesus die? Jesus died as an atonement for our sin. And what this atonement accomplishes is our cleansing and the removal of our sin from us. And this means that we can then be reconciled to God. We can be restored to fellowship with God by the removal of our sin, and this is done through the death of Jesus. God cleans us up and brings us into his presence, and it's not something I do, nor can I do. But these Pharisees think that this is a means to introduce the Gentiles into the same covenant relationship that they have. And so they think that Jesus is a doorway, a gateway into Judaism. So as far as they're concerned, it's believe in Jesus and obey the law, believe in Jesus and adopt the festivals, believe in Jesus and make our sacrifices, believe in Jesus and follow our eating customs, and believe in Jesus and be circumcised. Now, perhaps on some basic level, this faith in Jesus is about making us, if not an ethnic Jew, as far as they're concerned, but rather, because no one can change their ethnicity, but rather a cultural Jew, and then be saved. And so we see in verse 2, and the English Standard Version puts it, that there was no small dissension and debate. It's kind of an understated way of putting it. The NIV puts it, there was a sharp debate, and the New Living Translation says that there was a vehement argument. You know, we get a sense that voices were raised. We get a sense that the atmosphere turned ugly. So that really brings us on to the debate in Jerusalem. Before we get to that, let's just notice some of the details on the way. We read that Paul and Barnabas go up to Jerusalem. Jerusalem is in the hills. They're going to see the apostles, as we talked about before, the men with a unique authority. They make about a 360-mile journey, and they stop off at various churches along the way in Phoenicia and Samaria. So this is probably no less than 3 or 4 week journey. As we often find in the book of Acts, chunky periods of time elapse, and we don't get a sense of that unless we pay close attention. Now, they come to Jerusalem, and then there's a long debate, verse 6. And the basic topic for discussion is that whether the Gentiles must submit to the Old Testament law. And there are two basic features of this debate and discussion. And they really are testimony and scripture. So we're going to consider these two points. And the first testimony that is offered comes from Peter. And this happens between verses 7 and verses 11. And at this point, Peter reflects on his experience when he visited Cornelius's house. And you may remember that Cornelius, this little episode happens in chapter 10. So if you weren't here for chapter 10, I'm just going to give the quickest of reviews of that. There's a lot of material, so it's probably worthwhile anyway. So you may remember that there was Cornelius. He's an Italian centurion, and he's in Caesarea, which is sort of on the seaboard there, on the west coast of Israel. Not too clear, perhaps, but that's roughly where it is. And he is told to summon Peter. Now, Peter is nearby in another town called Joppa, and he's preparing his lunch. And he gets a pretty ugly surprise, because whilst he's preparing his lunch, he sees a vision. And in the vision, there is a sheet, and in the sheet, there are some unclean animals, unclean by the standards of the Old Testament law. And this comes down, and a voice says to him, "Rise, kill, and eat." And Peter objects to this, because he's never eaten anything unclean in his life before. But the voice replies, "What God has made clean, do not call common." And this happens 3 times. And just when he's trying to figure out what this means, the men from Cornelius's house turn up and say, "Can you come to Cornelius's house and speak to the people there?" So Peter, because of the vision, decides to go. And even though Cornelius is a Gentile, because of the vision again, he says that he thinks it's okay to go into the house of a Gentile. The kind of slight wrestling in his mind there, reminding us of the cultural background we've just been thinking and whether a Jew would go into a Gentile's house. There's a crowd gathered, and he preaches. And he preaches the message he's been preaching everywhere. Jesus went about doing good and healing people. He was crucified and then he was resurrected to life. And now he stands as the judge of the living and the dead. And then he comes to these words. Everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins. And it is just at this point in his address that belief in Jesus Christ brings the forgiveness of sins that the Holy Spirit falls upon them. And I'm assuming that there are tongues that take place at this part, because when Peter is relaying this episode later in chapter 11, we read that Peter said that what happened to the Gentiles is exactly what happened to us at the beginning. This is the Gentile Pentecost. And so Peter goes on to say, if then God gave the same gift to them as he gave to us when we believed in the Lord Jesus, who was I to stand in God's way? And so we notice that Peter preaches to the Gentiles. They believe, and that is evident by what he sees. And therefore we can conclude that God has accepted the Gentiles on account of faith in Jesus Christ. So this is Peter's testimony. The second testimony comes from Paul and Barnabas. And it's quite nice to notice some of the details here. Take a look at verse 12. We notice that when Paul and Barnabas come to speak, it says that the assembly fell silent. And they describe in detail, verse 3, what happened. So they go to Phoenicia and Samaria, and they've described in detail what has happened amongst the Gentiles. We must imagine that they described in detail in Jerusalem as well. And the assembly falls silent to listen to the first and greatest missionary report. This isn't the sort of missionary report which you might regard as an optional extra. Well, it's just the missionary report tonight. Perhaps we won't go. This one's got everything. Paul and Barnabas turn up in Cyprus, and there's the Roman leader of the entire island hears about them and wants to hear this gospel message. But this Roman leader has got a false prophet as a sidekick. So whilst Paul's trying to explain the gospel to him, this guy's trying to stop Sergius Paulus, his name, from hearing. And Paul ultimately becomes frustrated. And he rebukes this false prophet, and he goes temporarily blind. And on account of this miracle and the word of God, Sergius Paulus believes. Well, you're telling me that the Roman leader of the entire island of Cyprus believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, a Gentile? Yeah, that's what happened. No wonder they all fell silent. And then they go on to Iconium. I met with Graham Shanks, your pastor here, about 10 days ago to talk about Acts. And we talked a little bit about the role of miracles in the book of Acts. And Graham used the alliteration of miracle and message, you know, going together. And it's certainly true in chapter 14 and verse 3 in Iconium. We've got a different alliteration, but it's the same meaning. There's witness and there's word. The people preach the word of God, and God witnesses to the truthfulness and the authenticity of that word through the miracles. And so the miracles serve to illuminate the person of Jesus Christ and to grant authenticity to this message. So what's the point here? What is the point we're trying to make? Firstly, when it comes to Peter, God coordinated this meeting between Peter and Cornelius. Peter wouldn't have gone otherwise. And the Holy Spirit turns up to demonstrate God's acceptance of the Gentiles. In terms of Paul and Barnabas, there's miracles to authenticate the gospel, and this demonstrates again that God is at work amongst the Gentiles. So whether it's Peter and the Holy Spirit, or whether it's Paul and the miracles, what we notice is that God is at work amongst the Gentiles, and he is accepting people on account of their faith. Their trust in him. So Peter says in verse 8, God, who knows the heart, bore witness to them by giving them the Holy Spirit, just as he did to us. And then concerning Paul, they related what signs and wonders God had done. The point is rightly made, I think, that the Acts is indeed the Acts of the Holy Spirit, not the Acts of the Apostles, because the text actually says this is what God has done. And so in terms of applying this, and to be specific, God has opened the door, and it is on account of faith in Jesus Christ and not by the works of the law. And that is the point that they're making. Now, as a quick point of application here, I wonder if any of you are interested in apologetics. I wonder whether you quite like to debate questions and maybe even like to be given a reason to believe, you know, rather than just being told to believe. There's something pretty interesting happening through these chapters here. Consider Peter for a moment. He had to be told to go to the Gentiles, and he was surprised when God accepted them. And then take Paul. Paul used to persecute the Christians. He used to throw them in prison. And yet he becomes the person who takes the gospel to the nations. How was the gospel going to go global when those who were responsible for preaching it didn't even have a vision for the idea? How do we explain the growth of the church? How do we explain the fact that we're sat here 2,000 years later? There's only one explanation, and the scripture is clear. God is in this. This is something that God has done. And I find that very compelling. The second point is that we notice that neither Peter nor Paul launch a kind of a discipleship explored course. Nothing wrong with discipleship explored. What I mean by that is a Jewish equivalent. You know, they didn't say, right, guys, here we are in Iconium. We've got a limited amount of time. We're going to do a crash course 10 nights a week. And we're going to go through 10 really important points here. Number one, circumcision. Okay, now you've believed in Jesus. Okay, get out your Torah, flick through. Chapter 17, Abraham, circumcision. Turn to Exodus, Moses. No, there's none of that. That is not what is happening. And so Peter says in verse 9, he made no distinction between us and them, having cleansed their hearts by faith. How reassuring. He made no distinction between them, between us and them, but by faith. And then verse 11, but we believe that we will be saved through the grace of the Lord Jesus, just as they will. You don't need to become a cultural Jew to be saved, and this is the effect of the gospel. Now, this has implications for us today too, in the area of mission, certainly, but also our church, our Christian fellowship. I once had the opportunity to worship together with some Bangladeshi Christians in Bangladesh. And they were there to worship the Lord, and they did worship the Lord with sincerity. But there were certain features of their worship which were different. And so the shoes were taken off at the door, perhaps like you might have seen at the mosque, although I think that's normal in that part of the world anyway. The women sat on one side of the church and the men sat on the other, and the women had their head covered. It was quite New Testament in a certain way. The instruments that were used to worship were traditional Bangladeshi instruments, and the songs were unfamiliar to me. They were in a kind of a local tune. And of course, we don't need to become culturally British to be a Christian. There are certain cultural trappings in terms of how we do things, which kind of demonstrates that the gospel has found a home in the UK, having been here so long. But fundamentally, we don't need to change our cultural identity to become a Christian. An Indonesian, for example, imagine a scenario where some Chinese turned up in Indonesia to spread the gospel, and those Indonesians believed they wouldn't need to become culturally Chinese in order to become Christians. An Australian doesn't need to become American. A Brazilian doesn't need to become European. And the reason that the gospel has gone global is because it doesn't belong to any one culture. There is no distinction, only faith in Jesus Christ. Now, the second part of the debate in Jerusalem concerns scripture. And we notice this in verse 16 and verse 17. And we notice that scripture is used to measure these experiences. So it's not just a case of Peter and Paul turning up and saying, this is what's happened. They actually use what God has revealed in his word to measure it against these things and to see if they are legitimate. And verse 16 and 17 are a mixture, really, of Old Testament verses, which gives us the impression that they were probably quoting all kinds of Old Testament scriptures to see what God had to say about accepting the Gentiles. And what we notice is that there's a relationship between scripture and between their experience, the witness of the prophets and the witness of the apostles. And this mixture of Old Testament quotes makes the point that the Gentiles will be built into God's restoration project for humanity, so that all ethnicities might belong to him. And indeed, this has always been God's plan. So let's turn finally to this watershed moment. And we notice this here in verse 19, where James comes out with a judgment. Therefore, my judgment is that, and he carries on. This is James's conviction, his decision based upon everything that has been shared in terms of experiences and God's word. And we're faced with quite a curious turn of events here, because after having spent so much time thinking about whether circumcision and the works of the law should be required of Gentiles, all of a sudden we discover that the Gentiles who have turned to God should abstain from eating blood, things polluted by idols, and sexual immorality. Hasn't the debate in Jerusalem so far been about ridding the Gentiles of the need to adopt Jewish customs? Well, yes, it seems that way. So what's the difference between the previous discussion and what James suddenly announces here? The difference is that in the first case, the assertion that you must be circumcised to be saved puts salvation as the central issue. What they're saying is you must do this in order to be saved. But when it comes to this decision that follows by James here, no one is saying if you believe in Jesus, you should abide by our food customs to be saved. It's not about salvation. Rather, the issue now is that Jew and Gentile are sharing fellowship together. Why not make it easier for the Jews, these Jewish brothers and sisters, who, as verse 21 says, have had Moses read to them for ancient generations. These traditions and customs have become so normal for them, it's actually quite difficult for them to break away from them. And so this isn't an issue of salvation. This is an issue of being considerate towards this group of people. So what makes this a watershed moment is firstly that salvation by faith in Christ alone is nailed down, as it were, what makes you a Christian. But the second significant point is that the ethos of this Christian community is to be one of love and thoughtfulness for the different groupings within this international gathering of Christians. And this sense of thoughtfulness and consideration is in order that we might come together and have this fellowship. Now, I mentioned a moment ago that the power of the gospel to go global was that faith in Jesus belongs to no one cultural tradition. In fact, if you do a Google search and look at the different churches in Edinburgh, you'll find a Chinese church, and you'll find a Japanese church, and you'll find a Korean church, and I've no doubt there are some fellowship groupings of other nationalities as well. And of course, this is an encouragement, isn't it? This reminds us that the gospel has found a home within these different cultures. But it also reveals that there continues to be division along ethnic lines. And I wonder if we might consider how to make Christians culturally different to ourselves more comfortable in our company. I think that is one of the points of application that comes out of this passage. Now that the Christian church and the Gentiles and the whole variety of nationalities, it's not just about how we're saved, but how we can incorporate one another and reflect that breadth. So this is a watershed moment. We don't hear about Peter from this point onwards. Paul takes center stage. Jerusalem becomes less important, and Antioch comes into focus. And not only that, but we see Barnabas and Paul split and separate as well. This is quite jarring, actually, when you read chapter 15 and you see this effort to come together in unity. And then all of a sudden, after verse 35, Paul and Barnabas are off in different directions. What's going on? What we notice is that they're not split by a conflict about the gospel or defining the gospel. They're united in preaching this gospel. But they seem to have a different ethos of ministry. The way they want to go about things is different. But the result of that, in fact, is a multiplication of the proclamation of the gospel. So the outcome is actually a good thing, even though the narrative follows with Paul in the book of Acts. So what is the gospel then? Bit of a spoiler alert here. If we go on to chapter 16, don't want to take next guy's sermon. But Paul goes to Philippi and the Philippian jailer comes to Paul and he says, "What must I do to be saved?" And Paul replies with crystal clear clarity. And it is on account of what has happened in chapter 15, this resolution of these issues, that Paul is able to reply in the simplest and most straightforward terms possible. And it's the same message for us today. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved. Amen.
Stand and sing our last song as we close together.
So let's stand together.
Men of faith, rise up and sing of the great and glorious King. You are strong when you feel weak, in your brokenness complete. Shout to the north and the south, sing to the east and the west. Jesus is Savior to all. Women of the truth, stand and sing to broken hearts. Who can know the healing power of our awesome King of love? Shout to the north and
Well, what a joy to celebrate together the love of our Christ. Let's read, "Your love, Lord, reaches to heavens, your faithfulness to the skies. How priceless is your unfailing love, O God. People take refuge in the shadow of your wings." God bless you all as you go this week, and do stay behind if you can for tea and coffee, and join us this evening for our conclusion of Jonah. We'd love to see you. Bless you.
Be lifted up as we bow down. Be lifted up. Let the heavens rejoice. Let the nations be glad. Let the whole earth tremble, for you are God. Come and worship the Lord in the beauty of hope.